Hello, this is Real World Audio, and I am continuing going deep into the KLIPSCH RP600M bookshelf speaker, which is although it's not cheap by any standards, but come in the audiophile world, especially with today's crazy prices. It is regarded as a very affordable and cheap model. And of course, you can get loudspeakers maybe for $100 or something like that, which is at a fraction of the price of the KLIPSCH. But this represents an entirely different category of experience, because I don't think myself that you need to spend infinite amount on a loudspeaker to have a good sound. But sadly, the truth is that to have quality parts, quality components, they do cost money, and you won't get them on the cheap. And when you look at it in other examples in life, if you look at how parts quality and craftsmanship translates to experience, then compare a Fiat 500 to a Mercedes 600 series automobile, and then you get that how the parts quality translates to real world experience. And it's the same thing with loudspeakers, and that's the same thing with the parts quality in cars. You can get a car that has as strong an engine and drives as well as that Mercedes for a fraction of the price. Maybe you can build it, that's the best way, but in that case you will be compromising the looks, and you will compromise the other things, but maybe not the driving experience. However, in that case you need to go seriously off the beaten path and look into alternatives, which are not just slapping down a bunch of money and going home with the prize. And in response to Adam's question, truly, if you want a loudspeaker solution on a budget, it can be had, but I'm saying that not the only way, but the best way to do that is to build it for yourself. And I'm going to give advice on how it can be achieved. And before that, I'm going to return back into the analysis of the KLIPSCH. And now we are on the previous episode, we looked at its impedance and what kind of amplifier you need to drive it. So basically you need an 8 ohm amplifier, and we analyzed how come that it has such damn good high frequency handling capability. It's all in the previous video. So now let's go back to stereophile's review. Let's just adjust my camera. Okay, we are doing much better now, right? All right, and let's go down. Oh, okay, wait a sec. So let's just stop here. So previous episode, we took a dive into the right side of the frequency response curve. Let's see. So that's like 10 hertz and going up to 50 kilohertz. I think I did not show this on the previous episode. I was just zooming into this part. So when we go down, so this was the high frequency part. How high? Basically a kilohertz and higher. Now, if we're going lower than a kilohertz, what we see is that around 200 hertz, we see that impedance dip. So basically between 300 and 150 or so hertz, the impedance drops below 4 ohms. And that's why you need a 4 ohm tap. Otherwise, the male vocals will sound really flabby, and you will be not happy with the bass. So apart from that, so basically if you have an 8 ohm amplifier, then this range, like between, let's say that 120 hertz to about a few hundred hertz, you will have trouble with, and you will lose definition from that area, and you will hear excessive distortion for that range. Depending on your amplifier, if it's a solid state amplifier, well, most solid state amps can normally handle 4 ohm loads, but if they can't, then you will just kind of have a kind of like losing definition in the vocals. If you have a tube amplifier, then the vocals will sound richer and deeper and more pronounced, because you will start to have second and third order harmonics in the vocal range. And well, you might like that, some people do not. You can just try it out. But if you want the most out of the speaker, I do recommend the 4 ohm load to be able to handle everything. So now let's see, going lower. So here we have this high impedance peak at 100 Hertz. And that's because that's the self-resonant frequency of the woofer. So this guy here, when you put it in this cabinet, then at 100 Hertz, it tends to resonate by itself. So it means that it requires very, very little current to make it work at 100 Hertz. And this is what is shown in that figure, that high impedance, you see, it goes up to 20 ohms. It means that it requires 5 times less current to make it move at 100 Hertz compared to making it move at 200 Hertz. So it means that 100 Hertz is a piece of cake for it. But as you will see, this is the impedance phase curve, and it just swings really out just from the peak of that. So it's kind of compensates itself beyond really close to that 100 Hertz resonant frequency, and like 90 Hertz and 120 Hertz will be much more difficult and harder to drive. So it's kind of like a sharp little area, and that's the basically the, I would say, the lowest frequency that a basso has. So when you have a Nikolai Djaurov singing, oh no, that was really high, oh, something like that, then that deep voice will be coming through quite clear, provided he is singing the lowest register. Because if he goes higher, now that goes into that region, and if you are putting into an 8 ohm tap, then it will sound a kind of losing definition. So when we drop below that, this drop is because of the port. So when you see the valley of the impedance, this is where the port is tuned to. So that's where the that's what the curve tells us. And here, if you look at it, this is at 50 Hertz. So it means that for the loudspeaker, at 50 Hertz, it can take a lot of current to drive the loudspeaker, and it also means that if you have a tube amplifier, because of that low impedance, you need less inductance to reproduce that frequency. So for a tube amp, this frequency range will be coming through very strongly. It's because the output transformer has an easy job there. And when we go below 50 Hertz, then the impedance starts rising. And it also means that your amplifier's distortion is starting rising, both tube and solid state. And if you have a tube amplifier, then it means that you will need exponentially higher inductance from the output transformer as you drop below 50 Hertz. Because when you go lower with the frequency, you need higher inductance for your output transformer. But if you factor in that additional impedance rise, if you double the impedance, you need double the inductance. So it means that unless your tube amp has a pretty big size output transformer, then you will lose all bass, basically under 45 Hertz. And you need a really like a strong muscle transformer, either something really big, Like, for example, in the previous episodes, I was talking about using the big ad core or big Hammond output transformers, even though they are not regarded as a coveted or high quality transformer, but because of that big size and the high inductance that we see in the Hammond, ad core does not publish the inductance, so I don't know whether it has or not. But because of these two factors, they are able to handle, to drive the KLIPSCH down to there. So if you have a tube amp with a 5 kilo or 10 pound size output transformers, then you will be able to drive it down to 40 hertz. And if not, then at 45 hertz or so, that will be your bottom. And then you will literally hear next to nothing below that frequency. And if you have a big muscle amp, even then 40 hertz here, that peak will be the peak. These speakers will not play below that frequency. So when you look at the loudspeaker curve, then when you see, just look like here, that's like 1 kilohertz, you go under 1 kilohertz, and then you will see two peaks. And then the valley is where the port is tuned, so that's where your bass will have the best benefit. And this is where the driver works the less. So the cone needs to move the least here. If we go higher in frequency, it needs to move more. And if we go lower, then it also needs to go much, much more. And now also the frequencies are getting lower, so it needs to move way, way more. And when you hit the peak, if you go lower than that, it means that there's no more juice. This is the hard stop of low frequency response. So now let's have a look at how that hard stop works. So this is the breakdown of what's going on in the speaker cabinet. So the green, this corresponds to the horn. And now the blue, that corresponds to the woofer. And here, the red corresponds to the port. Do we see the port here? Maybe. Where is it? Yeah, we see the port. Okay, so the port is in the back of the speaker, so it's rear ported. And you see, that's what they say, it has a tactrix horn port, because it's not just a sphincter that's just shoved into most loudspeakers, but it's, you see, it has a horn on it, so it curves outside. And it's not just a round port, but it's a slot port. So a slot means it's a slot. So it's not a circle, it's a rectangle, and it flares out. And now when we look for that, this design will make a tremendous difference. And when you look at bookshelf speakers or any kind of speakers, even floor standers, which have that round port, most of them are suffering from the port chuffing. And Paul McGowan calls it farting. So your ported speakers fart. And that gives a coloration to the sound, and really like a oof, oof, kind of like a oof, oof. That kind of thing added to the low frequencies when you play loud music or there's like drums or something like bass, and there's this annoying smearing added to it. And most people don't really recognize this, but once you learn how to hear it, then you will be very allergic to it and identify it very easily. But even if you can't identify it consciously, those small ring ports, they really, really hold the bass response down. And it's not just the chuffing that those ring ports add to the sound. They make the entire bass response held back. It's like a restrained bass. So with this nice big port, what happens here is that because it's so much bigger, there's much more amount of air that can move through than through a small round hole. And because it's not a single hole with a single diameter, so there's no single resonant frequency transmitted through the port, it's wider, so it has like one fundamental frequency resonance and another, so it's divided between two frequency modes and not a singular strong mode. And then because of the horn, what the horn does is that it provides an impedance matching, an acoustic impedance, because when we go back here, this tells us about the electric impedance, but there's also the acoustic impedance. So the electric impedance, this means the relationship between your loudspeaker and the amplifier. And you can tell whether it's a good marriage or not based on this curve. But there's an equal curve that matches between your loudspeaker and your room. And if the curve is not good, then your loudspeaker is not matched to your room. It's a bad marriage. And guess what? That how your loudspeaker matches to your room is the most important parameter of any loudspeaker and stereo system. And guess what? There's absolutely zero or next to zero data on it when you look at publications. And partially that's because it has to match to your room. And none of the reviewers, John Atkinson, or name anyone, or any speaker manufacturer, nobody has access to the parameters of your actual room. Even you yourself don't have it, because if you rearrange your room, like you do like a massive change in the furnitures or layouts, then your room's acoustic parameters change already. So that's why that there's very little data on the acoustic interface between room and loudspeaker, because it is so variable. But it doesn't mean that it's not important. It is of the utmost importance. And here comes Mr. Klipsch, because the port here, what it does is, it's way too small to provide a horn loading for the bass frequency. It cannot. All this port can do to provide support is down to 700 Hz. And when you look at the port, it's tuned somewhere below 50 Hz, right? Around 45 Hz, what the data says. And 45 is like almost 20 times lower than what this horn is actually doing. So then you would say like, oh no, I've been lied to, because this horn doesn't do anything. It doesn't work as a bass horn. No, it does not work as a bass horn. But what it does, it is an impedance converter. So what's happening here is that when the air is coming out, then it doesn't just explode into your room. And that's what happens when you have these ring ports. And that's why the loudspeakers literally fart, because we have the same situation on our butt. There's this hole, and when the gas comes out, it just explodes into the room and you have that sound. And now, if you have these nice curves added to it, then that explosion is not just a sudden explosion, but the pressure has time to release. So as it goes out, then the pressure is getting lower as it comes out. And that's absolutely key, because those frequencies that are coming out from the port are much, much better to your room, much, much better suited to your room. It will work, so the acoustic coupling into your room will work as well as if the speaker had this big of a port. So that's the big advantage of using this horn loading for the port. So it doesn't add efficiency to 50 Hz, so your 50 Hz will not be any louder. It will not gain any dB because of that. But what it will gain is that 50 Hz will be heard much cleaner in your room, and it will not have added problems that that arise when you have this tiny hole and there's a great pressure wave. It comes out and it creates a mini sonic boom because it suddenly has to expand. And when the driver sucks it back, then there's a sudden major pressure decrease in the vicinity there. So and this results in turbulence. So when you have this tiny ring port, then the air is when it explodes, it creates turbulence around it. When it goes in, it creates turbulence as well. And it creates a huge mess. And when we have this situation, then the turbulence is drastically reduced. And that also translates into the driver. Let's just go back to looking at the driver. So this driver has a much better job driving that 50 hertz base because it doesn't have to fight. Imagine there's this turbulence going on with a small port version, and then there's this turbulence and the driver, it will make the driver resonate at the frequencies where this turbulence is happening. And now we don't have this turbulence. This driver is free to move in a much smoother, much controlled, much more controlled weight. And you don't need as high as a damping factor from the amplifier to drive it. And also, as an other side effect, it will be much more compatible with tube amplifiers, which do not like high damping factor. I mean, those loudspeakers that require high damping factors. And now I'm again at 20 minutes. I just can't believe it. So we'll go to third part if there's still anyone listening to this video. Thank you for tuning in. Bye-bye. Like, subscribe. Ciao.